the high school this week, I asked, what's the best memory that you have of your fathers? We're coming up to Father's Day, and I was really surprised that none of them could come up with a single positive memory. I sort of gave them ideas, I talked about trips they might have had, and the best they could come up with after a while was that somebody had been given a computer. So, unlike Mother's Day, Father's Day isn't quite this happy day where we celebrate the warmth and unconditional love and patience of our mothers. It's a day when a lot of people have painful memories. My own memory of my dad is that he never ever lost his temper. I was telling somebody about this in a car a few weeks ago. The guy was astounded that my dad had never once lost his temper or said something out of anger with us that he didn't mean. He said, oh, I wish my dad was like that. And I relate about how he had played Legos with us when we were kids, all the time he spent on special trips with us. And this guy was just amazed and said, oh, I'm so jealous. But unlike the clients that my dad had worked with to help recover from alcoholism and drugs, my dad wasn't my hero. He wasn't looked up to like they were. I always thought he was kind of uncool, and that being this gentle giant that he wasn't a man enough in the way that I wanted him to be. He was singing songs about God, which I didn't really relate to when I was little, and I remember being ashamed and embarrassed of him. And he was so big that his pants never fit quite right. He always looked like they were hiked up around the ankles, like he was ready for a flood. So maybe even if you had an ideal dad, this can be an awkward relationship. There's authority. It's hard to feel accepted. It's hard to feel like that relationship is easy. So why would God, who doesn't have a gender, when he came to earth 2,000 years ago, this man Yeshua, or Jesus as we call him in English, tell us that when we pray, we should address God as Abba. That word in Jewish today is synonymous with baby talk for daddy. In his day, it wasn't baby talk for daddy. There was another word they could use if they were a little baby saying daddy. It was an affectionate term, sort of like dearest father, but still a loaded term. I wanted to share two stories quickly, one from that Yeshua Jesus shared to describe what God was like as a dad, and one from my own childhood. A very common story that you probably heard before is that there was a father with two sons. This is a story Jesus told to describe what God was like. And that father, he was rich, and both sons wanted his stuff, wanted his money. The one son worked really hard, apparently to get it as his inheritance. The other was so bold that he said to his father, I want my inheritance now. Something very insulting, kind of like saying, I wish you were dead. Please, can I just have your money? The father surprisingly gives it to this son, and not so surprisingly, the son goes and blows it all right away. They say, easy come, easy go, and most lottery winners, it's all gone within a year. Well, so was the money. There was nothing much left. And when economic hard times come in the form of a famine, the son has nothing. He has to get the most undesirable job, shameful job for a Jew, working with unclean pigs. And he's so hungry with the little amount of money that he makes from this job that he's actually envious of the food the pigs are eating. Suddenly he gets an idea, well, my father's workers, they never go hungry. Maybe, and he starts to develop this elaborate story, I can go back and say, I've done wrong before you, Dad, and before God. Would you have me back as like a servant, a slave, a worker? So he's sort of rehearsing the story, you can imagine, walking back when, from a far way off, it says, the father says, son, you can picture him with arms out, and he says, come, and before the son can get this story out properly, he's saying, hey, let's get these filthy clothes off you, let's get a new suit on you, and get, oh, it looks like you pawned off your rings, let's get new rings on there, and bestow on you the dignity. You're my son. Let's restore that dignity to you, and let's throw a huge party to celebrate. You're alive. You're home. Well, somebody doesn't show up to the party. That's the brother who continues to go on working while the party is going on, and the father goes out to find him, saying, "Didn't you hear there's a party for your brother? Where are you? What are you doing? Why aren't you here?" And the brother says, "Dad, I've been working and slaving my whole life for you, and I could never get a party. And here your brother comes back. Do you know what he probably blew your money on? Prostitutes. And you're throwing a party for him to have him home?" And the father says to him, "Son, you've been with me this whole time. And I thought my son was dead, and now he's alive. We've got to celebrate that." So that was the first of two stories I wanted to share. The second is a true story that was not a true story that Jesus told about what his father was like. The second is a true story from my own childhood, which I'm not very proud of. I was a pretty reckless driver and had some friends who were probably poor peer pressure for me. And when I was about 16, I had some accidents. One of these was with, it was in front of a bar. I plowed into a Mustang and did a lot of damage to that. I didn't even have a job at the time, so I couldn't repay the damage. I didn't have enough money. And the police got involved because of how I responded to this accident. And the news came back to my dad. Now, what would you expect your dad to say when this happened? It was his car. It was his insurance even that I was under. And he discovered that I've done this. Maybe he would say something like, "What an idiot. What were you thinking? How can I expect you to have my vehicle when you're not responsible?" Or maybe I would be grounded, or maybe I would have the vehicle at the very least. My privileges taken away. No, my father's response was, "Are you okay?" And then I went on to learn that my father had a perfect driving record so many years without any kind of claim with the insurance company, that back then the insurance companies would actually give you a star, so that even if you did have a claim, your rates wouldn't go up. They would consider it a coincidence because your driving record was so spotless. They would just consider it a coincidence and you would get sort of a freebie, and your record would stay the same. So he gave me his perfect record and paid for the damages of this other vehicle under his perfect record, which I continued to drive under, and I continued to get to use the car. Now that was real grace shown to me, and it taught me something very important about my dad and his love and grace. As I've become a dad, I've tried to bestow on my kids the sense that no matter what they do, I want them to have that sense of belonging that the dad in that first story has, where no matter what they do, how they blow it, how they go off, I want them to always know that their identity is as my child, and that there's nothing they can do to destroy that identity. And I can always put those rings back on their finger and tell them, hey, no matter how you've blown it, how you pawned off everything, you will always be that child of mine. This is where you belong. I realize this is a different kind of role than the mother role, that they go to their mom when they're in trouble, they go to their mom when they need some sympathy, but that, as I learned around the high school table there at lunch, dads have a way of speaking truth and identity into their children's lives in a way that mom doesn't. We know that she's supposed to be nice, but dad is probably the one who'll tell you there's no Santa Claus, or when it comes to beliefs, maybe he'll say, you know, those religion people, they're just after your money, and that's good for your mom, she likes the community there, but why don't you stay away from it? Or, in the case of my father, they might tell you something very different about how science and the Bible and their own faith and their own lives have been changed, and they've seen things in a different way because of this very personal relationship they have. And it might have a huge impact on how you sort out your existence. Dads speak truth. They speak identity. They can either affirm confidence and say, you're a man now, or they can rob that, as I saw at the high school with all the very critical comments. So I want to take that job of a truth teller, identity teller, very seriously for my kids, and speak identity of belonging. And I want to be careful that the words I use build them up, because I recognize that's a unique role. I know that some of us might wear things that have been said to us, and we might be practicing the lines, knowing we've done wrong, knowing we've wasted our lives. We might be practicing the lines like the guy in that story, saying, well, maybe I can come back as a slave. Maybe I can pay it back. But What that story is to teach us is that we can't pay it back. The debt is too big. And that that's not what God wants from us anyway. He's not asking us to come back with a new identity as slaves. He's not there to condemn us at all. He's there to tell us that we're his children, that he is the only one can pay it, and he has paid it already. See, that idea of being called Abba, what didn't start with Jesus, the idea of addressing God personally started way back with even Moses and Abraham. Moses was given God's name. That name, YVHV, as we translate it, often is translated L-O-R-D in capitals, I've learned in modern Bibles. And due to the way that the Jewish people didn't want to use the name of God, we've stopped saying in those Psalms and calling out to Yahweh, Yahweh, help me in my time of need, like how David would have written in the Psalms, and we instead use this title, sort of like Majesty or Your Royal Highness, which isn't as personal, and God wanted it to be personal. I think we have to reflect on our own fathers as we think about how we're going to relate to our Father in heaven, our dad, because I don't think we can truly separate how our dads might have treated us versus how we would picture our God as dad to be and how he would treat us. If our dads gave us confidence and told us that we were worth something invaluable, I think we're going to carry that image with God. If they cut us down in their insecurities, or if in this very tough role that they have as fathers, they ran from it, ran from the family, or maybe ran away to substances or to alcohol. I think that's going to impact us too. Wherever we have experienced what a dad is like, I think we've got to, in the real world that we live in here, encourage our dads. As I've had this role put on myself, I'll tell you a secret, it's really challenging to lead people who don't want to be led. And the authoritative relationship that you have as a dad is one that we just don't want to accept. Even if you have a dad as ideal as my own, you get sons like me that just don't want to accept that authority, and they find flaw where there isn't much flaw. Or maybe there's a lot of flaw, but we still find a way to weasel out of the authority they have. I find that the best response that we can have with our fathers, good or bad, is to try and help them out in that role. See, it's hard to lead people who don't want to be led, and we might take out our frustrations kind of like we would on an old truck that doesn't work the way we want it to. And yeah, you could kick an old truck really well, but trucks, even though they'll run without all the air that they need in the tires or with their oil being changed regularly, even though they'll still keep going if you never wash them, they'll start to rust if you don't polish them and wax them. And the engine won't work as good if you don't change the oil. And the air in the tires, it'll affect it if you don't put enough in. What we could do for our fathers is encourage them, help them, even though they'll look like they don't require that, and they'll take the beating and the kicks that we give it. They'll be tough like a big truck. What they really need is respect. What they really need is our help to show them that their leadership is important and for us to go along with what they say so that they don't always feel like they're leading those who don't want to be led. I'll offer that little secret that you can help your dad in his role. Help him not to just check out. Help him not to try and run away from the family, really, or through some other means, to his sports, to his beer, to whatever else. But to take that role of truth teller and identity giver seriously. And even if you've had just the most hardest and most painful experience from your own father, we can all be so grateful that the father that God described himself as isn't out there doing this all the time, condemning us, but not only made us, but when we ran away and wasted it all, bought us back at the great price of his own life, of his own son's life, and bought us back at that huge cost so that we could once again belong to him and be his own. And he restored our identity as his child, saying, "You are so valuable, you are so worth it because you belong to me." Thanks for listening, and I hope you have a really happy Father's Day.